friends, the center of our whole relationship with God begins when Jesus touches you. If Jesus never touches you, you can remain in your old state. And if you are in the old state, you know what it means? The mind is carnal. When God speaks to you, you don't hear. And so your relationship with God is like, you know, you are there, but you are not there. And so, my friends, if you have not had that experience, an encounter with the Holy Spirit, encounter with God, that make you see that your life has transformed, has changed, and that your spirit and God's spirit agree that you are a child of God, please seek for that experience. Seek that God touches you and your life will never be the same. You will experience that peace, that joy. You don't see anybody in the church as an enemy, but rather a brother, a sister, a friend. You don't see anybody as the devil, because there is only one devil, the one who accuses us, who slanders us, who wants us to separate us from God so we can follow him. No, you can always see that God has created everyone in his image, and you will begin to love him or her the way God wants you. Shall we pray? Gracious and loving God, the time has come. People want to hear what you want to tell them. What says the Lord? I don't have anything to give to them. So speak through me to your people. Nurture them. Grant them what will feed the soul, that they will have that experience, the feeling that you have touched them, that you have changed their lives, that their lives are never the same anymore. Yes, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to thee, O Lord, my Redeemer, my friend, my Savior, in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Making life better for the young people. Friends, for the next 3 weeks, I have decided, last week I did one, I'm doing another one, and I'll do another one next week. Why are you talking only about the young people? Well, I'm talking about the young people because they are the future of our congregation. They are the future of our congregation. And they also deserve to know God so that they can live their lives according to what God wants, even many years after we are gone. Making life better for the young people. And the scripture for our reflection of meditation is in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 33. You are not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. You are only a young man. You only are a young man, or you are only a young man. Friends, before I even begin to unpack everything I want to say today, Some of the questions that I would want us think about going forward, it will reoccur, and I will never stop asking maybe until we get to where we have to get to. The young people have stopped going to church. Are we asking why? Does it bother us that young people have stopped coming to church? Sometimes we say, oh no, they are no longer interested in church. But if you go 10 blocks across the street, you go and see young people active. True or false? You see young people active. Why is that my church doesn't have young people who are active? And have we started asking why the young people are not coming to church? Have we lost touch with the younger generation and now decided that, oh, they should be on their own? And the next question is, how do we grow a congregation, a church, that reaches out and continue to reach out to the younger generation? Is it possible to ensure that our church reaches out to young adults, younger people, and their children, and find ways to continue it in future? To reach out to them and find ways to reach out to them and continue in the future. Friends, time and tide waits for no man. We should make hay while the sun shines. We should ask these hard questions and begin to figure out, to ask these questions and find out how we might bring the young ones in. Because for the hard work that you have put up all these years, some years when God finally calls you home, you don't want to hear that this building is now a restaurant or an apartment or something. No, never. We want this place to continue to be holy grounds where God's name will be proclaimed around the world. This is the time to find our successes. This is the time to find the younger people and nurture them in Christ, so that many years when we are gone, this ministry will continue to thrive and to flourish. Making life better for young people. You are only a young man. You can't go and fight these Philistines. So what does it mean when I say making life better for the young people? Actually, what I was going to preach about was problems caused by the seniors. And I said, oh, gee, I shouldn't go there. No, we do it unconsciously, my friend. So I wanted to see that, do we consciously, unconsciously create problems, put things in the way of the younger people, and therefore we drive them out? You see, the young people are smart. They don't fight their seniors. They don't argue with their seniors at all. But if they don't like, they advise themselves. The thing is that they are not showing up again. Told you last week that you can be sitting around the table with young people. They would be speaking to themselves, texting themselves about what you are doing, and they will make decisions. But we will sit now listening. No. They are actually talking. And you should go near their text to see what they are telling or what they are saying about you. That is the generation. That is the age. So What are the problems and the challenges that unconsciously we create and drive the young people out? Because we need to ask ourselves questions. And if we're doing this unconsciously, how can we correct so they can come back and have a space in this place? In fact, this is the time that youth ministries should thrive in the church, so that the young people can find security for their lives, even marry. Because you're going to marry somebody online, you never know what the person is. But if you grew up together in the church, you are sure to know what the person is. We need to make sure that the next year, 2 years, we focus on bringing wherever they are into the church. It is the challenge that we must. That's why I just want to make sure we reflect on our own behavior in the church, whether we unconsciously do things that drive young people away. In my former church, I had a young lady who was, say, around 26 years, had a baby. The child, love, he would tear off from the mother and slowly walk around, and whilst I'm preaching, she's in the pulpit, and people had a fit about it. I said, please, I know people cannot concentrate when they are distracted like that, but can't we resolve it in love? So this is the challenge that the church now begins to find an early childhood teacher who can take care of young people who have kids. The 20s, the 30s, they are the ones going to bring the kids to nurture them so they can grow in the church. Instead of being angry, why not making sure that we find a way to resolve it so the kid is not distracted? But people leave and they never even remember anything about the sermon except that they are upset that a kid who is about 2 years walk into the pulpit. They have never heard. And yet, the same people read the scripture that, let the young kids come to me, do not hinder them, for these belong to the kingdom of God. Now imagine you show this kind of hostility. What do you think a young person who is in 20s, now she will not show up church again? You have lost one, and you have lost a kid too. Is there a loving way we can approach situations and problems and pray for them and even offer that, oh, I will take care of your kid for whilst we are here? Church has become more hostile to young people, that we need to figure out a way to. And sometimes I will tell you that they are very overprotective. Kids love to play, right? When they come to church and you see them, oh, they get fit. But yet, every child wants to pray. Now, today's story, I chose the story about young boy David for us to see a few things about what was going on and perhaps learn from it. I hope, how many people don't know the story of David and Goliath? Sorry, it was very long, but I wanted to make sure we follow the story. How many haven't heard about that story? How many know that story? Everybody. If you don't know, go back and read entire chapter 17 of 1 Samuel chapter 17. Because let me tell you, no matter who you are, there's going to be a time in your life there will be a Goliath. In this story, it is very simple. Israel's is now, army is defied by one man, Goliath, all right? Now he come and insult them and they go. Same way I'm telling you, in your marriage, there will be a time that your husband can be a Goliath. Your wife can be a Goliath. Your kid can be a Goliath. Your working place, you can have a boss who can be a Goliath. You can have a worker, a staff member who can be a Goliath. When you are going to work, you are afraid. Fear grips you because every time what he will say, what she will say, what you will do, it haunts you. And my friend, when it comes, let us learn from what David did. The Goliath for this church is that we don't have the young people to succeed us. How do we deal with it? Okay. So you see that in the story, David is sent by his dad to go visit his brothers who are at war. Okay. He goes to see that there's a man bigger and taller than anybody in the world, saying things that make you fear. And once you see the size, you are not going to try. All right? And everybody was afraid, including Saul, who used to be the tallest man in the whole entire Israel. Afraid, because when they see the man, there's nothing they could do about it. Now, David go to see that this man is destroying. So he decides to take it up and to fight for the people of Israel. Of course, we know the story that he took him on and he defeated Goliath. But there are some things in the story that I want you to see carefully. You are going to observe that David was a young boy. That is why he was not enlisted in the army. If you go to Numbers, and sometimes even Deuteronomy and Leviticus, when God asked Moses to take a census, it's always 20 and above. So once nobody mentioned David's age, he was surely below 20 years. And boy, that's why he was not enlisted to go to the army, and yet he was able to take care of his father's sheep, all right? But his senior brothers were there in the army because their age forces them to go to war. So begin to see that David was a young boy. When they brought David to Saul, after he was talking around that, listen, I can go and take on this guy. Some men went to Saul to report that there's a young guy here who say he can go fight this man. So when they brought David to Saul, Saul said, oh no, you are not able to take on this guy because you are too young and inexperienced. Because guess what? This man has been fighting from his youth. So at least here you can see that Goliath was given the chance to fight from when he was young. And yet, the people of Israel will not let young people go fight. And sometimes in the church, we will not let young people fight. Do what is hard for us. We also see that Eliab, his other brother, was angry because he was a child, a young boy who should be taking care of his father's sheep. Why has he come to war? He even didn't ask the reason he was angry. It shows you that David was a young boy. But my friend, begin to look into the Bible carefully. God has always used young people to change situation. God used Samuel, all right, to change the nation, to bring it back to God. God used Josiah. He was only 6 years when he became king. All right? And Jeremiah was a boy when God called him. He was young. My friend, we have to make life better for young people, friends. We have to, because we are in a situation, we need to create room for the young people to feel that they have a space in the church. And so you begin to see that if you put things together, David is willing to put his life on the line to save the nation. But his brother is upset. That's one of the problems young older people do to the young ones. He's upset. Even for coming around, and yet his dad sent him. Saul himself is saying that you cannot go and fight this guy he has been fighting for from his youth. The soldiers themselves were making same remarks. And what does it mean? Let me tell you something. Young people don't fear danger. They want to try first. They risk, not thinking that they are in danger. And in risking this, they're able to learn great things. They love taking risks. But let me tell you, like my parents, they didn't want me. Right now, as I stand here, I don't know how to swim. Right? I don't know. And so when Hurricane Harry was coming, I said, oh my God, if this river comes here, how am I going to swim? I don't know how to ride a bicycle. I don't know how to climb a tree. All right? All these, my parents were overprotective, and therefore I did not get the chance to learn. When they do that, they think they are helping you, but actually they are not. So you begin to see that at least Goliath was young, he was allowed to fight and has gained more experience. What about us? Why can't we do the same for the young people? Now, in the church, I have heard adults say, when they leave, they don't come back. True or false? Have we asked why they don't come back? Maybe the church is boring to them. Maybe the music is boring to them. Maybe something is not right that they don't like, when yet we think they should like. Let me tell you what this pastor called Lee Creature of Amplified Church in Pittsburgh, a mega church, tells us, wrote in his book. He says, for a new generation, wrote, our church's approach can be so unappealing to young adults and children that the message we are sending them is, if you want to embrace the Christian faith, you will need to find another church. My church is designed primarily to be meaningful for me, not to reach you. So what Lee Creature is saying is this, that if we are not able to ask the hard questions, what is turning the young people away, whether our service is boring or there are problems that we are not giving ears to, we are simply saying that, you know what, I don't care about you young people. I'm okay with what is going on. You better find another church somewhere. And they respond to it silently. They try to do it their way, and that is why you can see that. Last week, I had a chance to meet one young lady called Jumi. Jumi is a bright, young, upcoming student who is going to college. She was reluctant to say anything against the seniors. No, you know, young people are very smart. They don't want to say anything. But there are two things I learned from Jumi. After I pressed on a little bit, she said, all right. Well, sometimes if we put up a play or singing, there are some people who might say, oh, it's not Methodist not enough. Sorry, it's not holy enough. It's not good enough. So this kind of statement, that's what discourages them. Now, can we do better by saying that even if it was a secular play, can we encourage them by saying that well done, but can you try and next time when you do, say, a play, do Esther, do the prodigal son, tell them they will read, create something and do for the church. We have to figure out a way because these young people are very creative. And if you tell them, they will come up with an idea and begin to do what you want them to do. Friends, time has come for us to understand that if we don't make life better for the young people and listen to them and decide that only the way we think we are going to go, then eventually what is going to happen is that we will lose them forever. Time has come for us now, every one of us, to sit down, close our eyes. How best can I help? How best can I listen? Can I even take one of these and make them a friend and hear what they say? You know, to me, there are three things that I just want us to do going forward. We should now start asking ourselves the hard questions that can help us identify what the problem is for the young people in our church. It's not, listen, people think that I love hymns. Let me tell you, I enjoy hymns. They are very inspirational. They are awesome. But if the kids don't like it, I shouldn't force it on their throats. And I'm hoping that a day is coming where we will create a situation for them to show us what they like. In fact, I'll tell you that as I sat with Jomi and I talked and I was asking a question, you know what she did? She said, you know something? I'm going to text one or two of the friends who are in the church who are not coming or something so that I am leaving, I will not be there, but I will text them too. So I said, awesome. And I said, please, but let them tell their parents first. Let me tell you, they know how to find themselves. If Jomi was going to be here, I would let the three people or whoever she called start something that I was going to see how they are nurtured and they grow. Listen, I'm not going to force and say, you should have Bible study. You should have Bible study. You can't clean a fish if you have not caught the fish. First of all, let them have confidence that they have a space in the church. And slowly, we can nurture them in our way so they can grow. But until they have a space that they know they can thrive. And let me tell you too, if they know that this is what you want, they will do that. One time when I was in Harlem, I got somebody who was teaching dancing in that church. There were no kids, right? She went to the street and grabbed young people. She got about 12 of them and she was teaching them. How she did it, I don't know. Okay, one of this kid was like, I would say that was the kind of boy who is so spoiled that his life is opposite of what any Christian faith would look like. Now, when he started coming to the group and the way they were nurtured, there was a time he misbehaved and he was ostracized from the group. Guess what? He felt so bad, he came to apologize. When I knew his background, then I know that when they are in the space, they slowly change. They may not change as fast as we want, but they slowly change. Friends, time has come for us to understand that we need to find out what the real problem is with the young people and begin to see that maybe sometimes loneliness is in the church. Sometimes we chastise them too much. Okay, sometimes we use negative words and discourage them. And seniors should be willing to change their ways toward young people after we ask these questions. Love them, encourage them, converse with them, and make sure that they are okay. There's nothing wrong if these kids, you find them and you encourage them. You went to Paris, when you are coming back, you buy some little parcel for them and listen to their story, listen to what they are doing in school. They will grow to love the church. And so when they leave, they know it is their home. They will come back. There are many ways we can encourage them, you know. But listen, when you want to work with kids, let them create what they want. Don't force anything on them and just listen to them. And you know, the seniors, we have the maturity, we have the wisdom, we have the money, but we should also give them the freedom to guide them, but not to force them. They take time to change. They take time to transform. We ourselves, if God look at how sometimes difficult we are, God can leave us. God is patient with us, all right? Why can't we be patient with the young people, listen to them, encourage them? You know how our kids are at home. Whenever they do something wrong, you know how you talk to them, you encourage them depending upon the age, and they learn. It may take longer time, but they learn. Friends, let us make things better for our young people in the church. But it all comes to the point. Like, if you have received Christ in your heart, if you have surrendered your life to Jesus, your desire will be to pray for them. You will love them, pray for them, encourage them, and help them. It's a journey. They are not going to change overnight for the way you want to see. And sometimes it disturbs me when I hear people say, oh, this is not Methodist enough. Do you know the Methodist? Do you know the Methodist way? Come, if you are talking about Methodist way, come, let's talk. Because if you talk about the Methodist way, it is about John Wesley and prayer. Okay? Homo Unius Libri, a man of one book. Are you studying in the Bible? It's Latin. His personal life and the way he read the scriptures. He got up 4 a.m., read the scriptures, prayed. Before 7 a.m., he was telling people about Jesus. This way is the class meetings where we have small groups where they study the word. And each one, they make sure that everyone is okay, what is going on in people's life, whether their soul is okay or their physical body is okay. That's the Methodist way. The Methodist way is meeting 5 days in a week, praying morning and evening. That is the Methodist way. Methodist way is fasting twice in a week. That is the Methodist way. Methodist way is sanctification, living life of holiness and moving into perfection. Yes, that's the Methodist way. They talk about scriptural holiness, social holiness, no drinking, no gambling. That is the Methodist way. The Methodist way is earn as much as you can, save as much as you can, give as much as you can. That is the Methodist way. Methodist way is taking care of the poor. Methodist way is visiting the prison, those in prison, those in the hospitals. Methodist way is the pants where a group of people will covenant to pray and do something in the church that helps the church to grow. Methodist way is the camp meetings where they spend a couple of days in a secluded prayer place where preachers come to preach, sing inspirational hymn, and the Holy Spirit will fall upon them. Methodist way is revivals, my friend. All Pentecostals came from the Methodist way. Where is the Methodist way you talk about? If we can go back, this church will transform. So don't make it look like Methodist way. Sometimes it's some traditions we have structured in the church, which is actually non-biblical. So if you want to talk about Methodist way or the Christian way, we can use the Bible. But don't let tradition stop these young people. Friends, time has come for us to wake up. Time has come for us to wake up, because if you go to the history of this country, when there was first spiritual awakening in the 1700s, the Methodists were part of it. Then in the second spiritual awakening that started late 1700 and 1800, Methodists were part of it. Methodists are known to bring renewal, but now we are sleeping. Let us rise up, begin to hear the voices of the young people, make it better for them, so that someday they will rise up, grow, and someday they will take over from us, make sure that our congregation remain relevant. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.